guys for giving me a chance to speak here. It's a great honor for me to be here in such a distinguished institute. When you look at a priori estimates for the P-Laplacian, C1 alpha estimates are one item, for instance, and if you look there for the constants in these estimates, the constants cause difficulties when p goes to 1 or when p goes to infinity. For p between 1 and infinity, the constants are controllable. I admire people working in regularity. I'm not very good at it. So I looked at the cases p equal to 1, p equal to infinity, and there were some problems and solutions to be found. And the key to the problem was something that I learned from Giorgio Talenti, and that's that the Laplacian can be written in something that I call intrinsic coordinates. So the Laplacian is the sum of second derivatives. And if I put the coordinate system in such a way that one of the coordinates shows in direction normal to a level surface of U, and the other directions are orthogonal to it, then I can rewrite it like this. The direction of steepest descent of a function is this, and the divergence of this tells me how much the normal to a level line rotates, so it tells me something about the curvature of a level line or a level surface. And so one just differentiates out the divergence and finds out that the Laplacian shows up there. And then you can rewrite the Laplacian in these coordinates. Every student who took a course in PDE knows this formula because they had to calculate the Laplacian in polar coordinates. And there it is. For radial functions, it's u double r plus n minus 1 over r times du by dr. So that's a familiar formula somehow. And you can do the same with the P-Laplacian. So you write a P-Laplacian and you find out that here instead of 1 you have a p minus 1. And I will also talk a little bit about one homogeneous version of the P-Laplacian. P-Laplacian, as we heard yesterday, is not one homogeneous in general. But if we multiply it, for instance, say with a power gradient u to the 2 minus p, then it is homogeneous of degree 1 again. And if you rewrite this in intrinsic coordinates, it turns out to be a convex combination of the infinite normalized P Laplacian and the normalized 1 Laplacian, where the infinite normalized P Laplacian is just the second derivative in direction of the normal. The normalized regular Laplacian is 1 half times Laplacian U. That's I think physicists prefer to write it that way. And this is the 1 Laplacian, the normalized 1 Laplacian. There are also parabolic counterparts. So you can look, say, at solutions to this equation or an homogeneous equation or to that equation. And this equation has been studied by a PhD student of mine, Kerstin Döss, who proved the existence of viscosity solutions and so on and so on and certain qualitative properties, and also by Agnet, who studied regularity for this equation. These equations are sometimes used in image processing. And in image processing, the basic problem is that you have a picture that is somehow perturbed. This is a photo of the black and white photo of the Cologne Cathedral, landmark in the city of Cologne. And here the image has been perturbed by pepper and salt noise. And So 50% of the pixels have been replaced by white or black pixels stochastically. And so she took this picture and she took it as an initial value for this normalized P. Laplacian equation and looked how it evolved in time for different values of P. And this is for P close to 1, and this is for P close to infinity after 5 identical time steps, and then after 15 identical time steps. So here the picture seems to get more blurred, and here it seems to preserve the contours somewhat better, which I found a surprising outcome of this numerical experiment. Now, let me look at these equations for P equal to 1. When P is equal to 1, the 1 Laplacian here, this is called total variation flow, because the solution of such an equation diminishes total variation over time. And this equation has been studied in a series of papers in the 1980s by Craig Evans and Sprague. And they developed a theory of viscosity solutions for that equation. So they perturbed it. Instead of writing, say, 1 over modulus gradient u, they replaced gradient u by square root of epsilon squared plus gradient u squared, and then they had a solution u epsilon, and they showed what happened to it when epsilon goes to 0. Now, I wanted to somehow decide which equation should be better, this one or that one, for image processing, say. So I made an ansatz, a function of time times a function of space, and I said, well, let's suppose A is homogeneous of degree D. And this leads to an eigenvalue problem. A applied to U is lambda U. Minus A applied to U is lambda U. And to a time decay, and this time decay is either too fast or too slow if the degree of A is not 1. And it's exponential only if the degree of A is equal to 1. So therefore, and two operators for which the which are homogeneous of degree 1 are either this one or that one. Yes. So there's a sign error here somewhere. Let me write a plus A here, because no. Yeah. Anyway, so you arrive at this equation equal to lambda u. That's this one, or you arrive at this equation equal to lambda u. This looks like almost like a linear equation, because this is homogeneous of degree 1. But the operator is not in divergence form, which is a disadvantage and an advantage at the same time. So now let's look at the Dirichlet problem for the P. Laplacian. When we look for the first eigenvalue, it minimizes this Rayleigh quotient. And it's easy to show that it exists a minimizer, and it has only one sign, and so on. But what happens to this eigenvalue and to the eigenfunction as p goes to infinity? Now, the eigenvalue goes to 1 over the in radius of the domain, to a geometric quantity associated to the domain. And the non-negative eigenfunctions, they converge to a Lipschitz function v infinity, which solves this equation in the viscosity sense. That's a very fundamental paper of Eugene and Lindquist about fading. And here the infinity Laplacian is not the normalized infinity Laplacian, but it's just gradient v squared, v double d. And, oh, there's a u missing here. The limiting equation for this one. One might expect that you replace p here by infinity, and on the right-hand side you have something that depends on lambda and on u itself, so on v. But this is not the right equation. This is the right equation. Now, infinitely harmonic functions are also interesting. You can consider, for instance, a p-harmonic function on a given domain with prescribed boundary data and see what happens when p goes to infinity. Then the limit of these p-harmonic functions goes to an infinite harmonic function. And this is infinite harmonic in the sense of viscosity solutions. And the infinity Laplacian operator, I believe, was first studied by Gunnar Aronsson. He did mechanical experiments with sand rolling down from a point source. I mean, say you have a funnel, a funnel. You put sand in there, you let the sand run out, and then a cone starts forming. So these cones look like this. Then he asked, what is the differential equation for the surface of the cone? Or if we have two point sources and these cones merge, what is the differential equation for this strange surface there? And he came up with the idea, well, if the slope gets too large, then the sand starts rolling. So the second derivative in normal direction should be zero. And that's the equation, the second derivative in normal direction should be zero. Now, when you zoom in on this cell here, it looks like this, rather bad and growing cells. So in one direction it goes like this, and the other direction goes like that. And the cell has the form x to the 4 over 3 minus y to the 4. This is not a C2 function. And for viscosity solutions can be just continuous, even semi-continuous. So it's a good candidate for viscosity solutions. Now, to test if something is a viscosity solution, you have to put a smooth function from above and show that it satisfies some differential inequality, or a smooth function from below. But say in this settle point itself, if you try to put a smooth function from below, it doesn't work. The set of test functions that you can apply there is empty. So it's easy to be a viscosity solution in points where the function is not classical. Let me look at the one-dimensional case of the infinity Laplacian eigenfunction. So this is the equation, and we said that the eigenvalue is 1 over the in radius. If I look on it on the interval minus 1, 1, the in radius is 1. So the eigenvalue is 1, and the eigenfunction is just 1 minus modulus x. And why is it a viscosity solution of this equation? Now, first of all, let us test with a test function from above, say in a point here, and we find out that the gradient of that test function is equal to 1, while the value of the test function is less than 1, so this one is bigger than 1. But this one's also bigger. This one's less or equal to 0, because the Laplacian of the second derivative of phi is bigger or equal to 0. So this one is less or equal to 0. So this one is 0. This one is greater than 0. It is satisfying. If we take a point up here, the second derivative of phi can do anything up here. But phi prime is less or equal to 1, less or equal to 1. So this term is less or equal to 0, and this is what we have, what we need for a subsolution. For a supersolution, we have to test with functions from below, and at this point, there's nothing to check because we don't have a smooth function that touches in that point. At any other points, it's trivial. Okay. Now, when p is between 1 and infinity, it is known that the first eigenfunction is simple. But when p is equal to infinity or p is equal to 1, we lose simplicity of the first eigenfunction. What about the second eigenfunction? Now, the second eigenfunction has to change sign, so it has a nodal line. And in the linear case, and if we have a square, the nodal line can be horizontal or vertical or diagonal. Yes? Yes, in a linear case, yeah, in a linear case. Then we have, and for the square, we have very simple nodal lines. For the disk, we have a diameter as a nodal line. This is well known. For p equal to infinity, the diagonal provides a larger in radius for each nodal subdomain, and therefore, 1 over the in radius is the first eigenvalue for a nodal subdomain. It should be the second eigenvalue for the full square. And in fact, numerical experiments show that for p between 2 and infinity, the diagonal seems to be the preferred nodal pattern. But I cannot prove this. Yeah. Yes. Okay, yes. There are various ways to define them, and one of them is by a mountain pass argument. So you go from the function u, among all sign changing functions, I think, to the function minus u. So there is a mountain pass characterization of this second eigenfunction. I don't have that citation right now yet, but I can look it up. As a matter of fact, I will come to that later. Incidentally, if you want to look up any of my papers and don't find them on my webpage I usually have the preprints and the final published versions for copyright reasons. I don't have on my webpage, so write to me and I'll be happy to send you the final version. And for p equal to 1, it turns out that the preferred level line is the horizontal or vertical one. Because when you set p equal to 1, what you're really trying to do is you try to minimize the length of the nodal line, subject to the constraint that each nodal subset is the same size. And then the shortest line that does this is a vertical one, or horizontal. And again, numerical experiments show that for p between 1 and 2, then this one is preferred. So on a disk, and for p equal to infinity, we're looking for a nodal line that has a large in radius. And for instance, this one has an in radius, which is the total radius divided by 2. But also does that one as well. So these are two conceivable nodal lines. I don't know which one is taken. And for p between 1 and infinity, at least it has been shown that the nodal line cannot be a circle in a paper that appeared last year by a noob who's in the audience. I guess it's here. It's Grabeck and Zazen. So we know very little about nodal lines, even for very special domains in the general. Now, when you set p to 1, and you look at the first eigenfunction, this is what it looks like. So in the limit, it tends to the characteristic function of a subset of omega. And this characteristic function is called a giga set, and it's the subset of omega that minimizes perimeter over volume. Now, the perimeter has a smaller dimension than the volume, therefore, you try to make the set as large as possible. You start with a little disk inside the domain, and then you blow it up. You find out that, okay, this ratio becomes smaller and smaller. But the domain that is the giga set for a square looks like this. You take a ball with appropriate radius, and you rotate, you move it around inside the domain at any place where you can move it, like these cleaning machines that run around, will form the union of all these balls, will form the giga set. And the constant is determined, and the radius of this disk is determined by perimeter over volume, by the giga ratio, the optimal ratio. So that's again a very geometric question. Given a set omega, find a subset that minimizes perimeter over volume. And for a square, what can determine the giga set? For a cube in three dimensions, it is open. It's not the union of balls, because you can show that the giga set, where it does not touch the boundary, so where there's a free boundary, it has to have constant mean curvature. And okay, in two dimensions, the boundary is one dimensional, has constant curvature, must be an arc of a circle. But in higher dimensions, it's not the case. Well, for convex omega, it is known that the giga set is convex and that it is unique. In two dimensions, the proof is relatively easy. In higher dimensions, it is complicated. And I would like to see a short proof in higher dimensions. If anybody has a short proof, please let me know. When omega is not convex, you have non-uniqueness. A simple example is, say, a barbell domain. Well, if these two rectangles were identical, you would have one giga set here and another one over there, and the union of the two. And so those are three different ones. Or you can have an L-shaped domain, and if the measures of this L-shaped domain are appropriate, there's a giga set that looks like this. And one that looks like this, and one that looks like this. So like a trombone, you can move it up and down. Now I want to look at the Neumann problem for the P-Laplacian. And the first eigenfunction is a constant. So I'm looking for a function that is orthogonal to constants in a certain sense. So it satisfies this side constraint. And it minimizes the Rayleigh quotient again. What do we know about these eigenvalues, and what happens again as p goes to 1 or p goes to infinity? Now, as p goes to 1, formally we minimize the total variation over functions whose L1 norm is given. And the side constraint becomes this. The sine of the integral over the sine of V should be 0. So the set of positivity should be the equal size as the set of negativity. And so you can choose minimizers to be plus 1 on one subset, minus 1 on another subset. And then what you try to minimize is the dividing line between the two. And so you want to subdivide a domain omega into two parts of equal area, and you want the dividing line to be as short as possible. So this is known as a sensing problem. You want want to find the shortest fence that divides a piece of land into two pieces. And there was a conjecture of Bolyai in the 1950s that said, this shortest fence, given the area of omega, how long could it be in the worst case? And he conjectured that it would be the disk, and then it would be the diameter of the disk. This is something that remained open until a few years ago when Italian colleagues and I were able to solve it. And these problems are applicable. I mean, it is meaningful to study problems how to divide subdomains, because, say, when you want, in parallel computing, you want to subdivide a domain into several subdomains, and then on each subdomain you do local calculations, but at some point you have to exchange information between the subdomains, and the amount of computation is proportional to the length of the interface between these subdomains. So if you have small subdomains, your computing gets more efficient. And in fact, Gerhard came up also with this problem in such a context. Now, when P goes to infinity, the following result is known. First, the eigenvalue lambda P goes again to a geometric quantity 2 over the diameter of omega. And remember, the first eigenvalue of the Dirichlet problem went to 1 over the in radius of omega. But in general, the diameter is more than twice the in radius. And the first eigenfunctions, they converge to a viscosity solution of something complicated. Well, the last one is easy in the Neumann condition. This one is the same equation that we had for the first Dirichlet eigenfunction. It was positive. And you have to pay attention when u is negative, then some of the signs get reversed. And this was shown by Rossi and Santier, that this is the limiting equation. And together with Kalmanich, I was able to prove that this is in fact the smallest non-trivial eigenvalue, because at least when omega is convex. So lambda infinity is in fact the first positive eigenvalue of 3, and is said to be shown in the next term. Now, the fact that this lambda infinity is a geometric quantity has some interesting consequences. The first one is that you have something called the Sege-Weinberger inequality. Sege-Weinberger's inequality says that the second eigenvalue among all membranes of given area becomes maximal. Second Neumann eigenvalue becomes maximal for the disk. So you have this inequality. Omega star is the ball of the same volume as omega. And since under symmetrization, the diameter decreases. For general P, one does not know this, except in some special cases. For P equals to 2, in general omega, this was the result of Sege and Weinberger. Or conjecture of Sege and Weinberger, I think it was first proved by Stickgold in two dimensions. Maybe Weinberger then in general dimension, yes. Sege conjecture. For P equal to infinity and convex omega. That's because we have shown that this, we need convexity here because we need to know that, that this really is the second Neumann eigenvalue. And since the diameter is in general more than twice the in radius, this is the proof of P equal to infinity. And for P equal to 1, this was the result that I just mentioned about the longest, shortest fence. For convex omega, we also have the inequality, and this one, and then the Neumann, second Neumann eigenvalue is smaller than the first Dirichlet eigenvalue. And for finite p, one has even a stronger statement in the case that omega is convex, and for general p, again the result of Boscoli and Gentilometri, and for p equal to 2, this is a combination of Faber-Kahn and Sege-Weinberger inequality. First, Dirichlet eigenvalue among all domains of given area is minimized by a disk. The first non-trivial Neumann is maximized by a ball, and then you can compare the two because you know them explicitly. And finally, when you have convex omega, no Neumann eigenfunction associated to lambda infinity. That is not connected to the boundary of omega. Okay. Now, how does one prove these things? I want to give you some ingredients of the proof. First, let me define the intrinsic diameter of the distance of two points. By this, I mean, say, if I have a non-convex set. And I want to get from x to y inside omega. I will take a straight line here and a straight line over there, and I will go part of the distance along the boundary. That's the intrinsic distance. Distance is the length of this, and it coincides with the Euclidean distance if omega is convex. So how do you prove that lambda p goes to lambda infinity? Two steps. This one is easy. You pick a point, x0 in omega, and you adjust the constant so that this function that measures the distance to this point x minus the constant cp is an admissible test function, so that by subtracting a constant, this one changes sign, and then it has to satisfy this orthogonality condition. And then when you evaluate the Rayleigh quotient, well, the gradient of the sine distance function is 1. So the enumerator is just the measure of omega. And this is what the Rayleigh quotient is. And then you see what happens to this expression when p goes to infinity. And you find out that it converges to something that is greater or equal to the diameter of 0 and 2. To show convergence in the other direction, we go to the next page. And there are two steps. The first one says you have to say what these eigenfunctions do. You have to show that they converge, and in fact, one can show they are uniformly bounded in some WMP, and W1P, where P is bigger, W1M, where M is bigger than the space dimension N. So since they are uniformly bounded, they are by Sobolev embedding, they are uniformly bounded in C0 alpha, so they have a uniformly convergent subsequence. And that limit is U infinity. That's the natural candidate. And in fact, the limit of the Rayleigh quotient is this one. And when you analyze this side constraint for as p goes to infinity, then it implies that the supremum of u infinity must be equal to minus the infimum. So maximum and minimum have exactly opposite signs, but are of the same magnitude. And since the L infinity norm can be written as 1/2 the difference supremum minus infimum in this case, and the supremum minus the infimum is less than 1/2 times the diameter times this one, yes, because it is, well, you use, I don't know, you go along there. basic, and you integrate the derivative of u. And the derivative of u is bounded by its is the gradient. And you estimate this integral. So this is how you get this inf equal to lambda infinity. And then, of course, we're showing that the limiting function is a solution of the limiting equation. We have to work a little bit harder. That's technical. Now, suppose the u infinity is scaled to 1, and it takes its infimum in a point x and its supremum in a point y. Then u infinity increases with constant slope along the geodesic from x to y. And in particular, in the one-dimensional case, the diameter of this interval is 2. So 2 over the diameter, which is the eigenvalue, is 1. And this function u of x equal to x is a viscosity solution of this equation. Now, since it's a linear function, u double prime is equal to 0. So this term is 0, and this term is 0, and this term is 0. And therefore, it satisfies the equation in the viscosity sense. But it clearly violates the boundary condition in the classical sense, because on the boundary, u prime is equal to 1. So. And then one has to go to Crandall, Ishii, and Lyon's primer of viscosity solutions and look up what does it mean that the solution of a boundary value problem satisfies the boundary condition in viscosity sense. And it means for a subsolution that either phi prime at 1 is less or equal to 0, or that the differential equation is less or equal to 0. This took me a while to understand until I came up with the following observation. Let's look at the heat equation. U sub t minus uxx equal to 0. In a space-time rectangle. So this is x and this is t. And let me call this space-time cylinder omega. Okay, I add here minus epsilon utt. And then this becomes an elliptic problem with the solution u epsilon. And I can prescribe Dirichlet data on the boundary of omega. This is an omega. And then I find, of course, a unique solution because it's a nice Dirichlet problem for a rectangle. When I send epsilon to 0, I get a viscosity solution of the limiting equation. And this viscosity solution solves the heat equation. And it satisfies the boundary values here, here, and here on the parabolic boundary. But of course, in general, it violates the boundary values up here. Instead, it satisfies the differential equation up there. So along this line, on this part of the boundary of the space-time cylinder, the solution is a classical solution of the heat equation. And so if one asks for that condition, then this is a the theory of viscosity solution shows that this is the limiting equation that you should expect. Then you get this as a natural constraint. And let's see what this means. For instance, if we have here a function touching from above, then phi prime will be positive or negative, so we don't know anything about this condition here. And therefore, we have to look for that part. Phi double prime could also have any sign, positive or negative, so we cannot rely on that one. But this one works. So phi prime, modulus of phi prime is less than 1 if it touches from above, whereas phi is equal to 1. And lambda is equal to 1, so we have something less or equal to 1 minus 1, which is less or equal to 0. So this one works. And when we touch from below, we satisfy this equation. And this can only be done in this case if C prime is bigger than 1. So we cannot have a function touching from below. That does not have to slope bigger than 1. But in touching from above, it is this first part that is sort of the active part in the definition of the Moskowski solution. Okay. So on a rectangle, we said the first eigenfunction goes from the maximum to the minimum with constant slope. And on a rectangle, this function goes from one diagonal to the other with constant slope. And these are numerical simulations of, say, U15 in this case, and the diagonal view and the side view in diagonal direction. Now, on a rectangle, you may say, okay, there are also one-dimensional solutions, like the one we just saw, U of x equal to x1. Now, these are level plots for general P. Okay. Yeah, I'll come back to that in a minute. But, yeah, for a square and P equal to 2, lambda 2 is known to be a double eigenvalue. We have cosine x and cosine y, say. And there are solutions with diagonal and horizontal or vertical nodal lines. There are also one-dimensional solutions for p equal to infinity, but they are associated to higher eigenvalues than this lambda infinity. And to see this, let's take the one that we just had and extend it into two dimensions. U is C2. Laplacian of u is again 0 in the classical sense, even. So it satisfies the differential equation. In order that the boundary condition is satisfied, we need to know that the modulus of gradient u minus lambda times u is greater or equal to 0 on the set on which u is bigger or equal to 0. And this implies that on the boundary where u is equal to 1, that lambda is less or equal to 1. Neumann boundary condition is satisfied in the classical sense on horizontal parts. Excuse me. No, this is part of the differential equation. We want this to be greater or equal to 0 inside the domain. So when we come to the boundary condition, we have to check again for functions touching from above and from below what happens. And at the right end, at x1 equal to 1, the u by the nu is equal to 1, and there this constraint is active. Sign error somewhere. Anyway, we'll go through all these constraints and finds out that lambda must be bigger than 1. But if this eigenvalue to the one-dimensional solution is equal to 1, then this eigenvalue is bigger than 2 over the diameter of omega, which is lambda infinity. Therefore, the lambda is bigger than lambda infinity. Therefore, the one-dimensional eigenfunction is a higher eigenfunction. So now, let me look at eigenvalue problems for the normalized P Laplacian. They have also been studied, but the results there are very scarce. So one has an estimate of this type, lambda infinity, is between something that depends on outer radius and in radius. For P greater than 2, the eigenfunction is again unique, modulo scaling. And for star-shaped domains, it's very curious, one has convergence of these eigenvalues for non-star-shaped domains. This cannot be shown. And what happens in the limit P to 1 appears to be totally open. I looked at this equation on a ball, and I looked just for radially symmetric eigenfunctions, because then the normalized P Laplacian becomes an ordinary differential equation. It looks like this. And that's a linear equation. And we know how to solve these linear equations. P is equal to 2, it's the Laplacian, and then we have the Bessel functions and so on. If P is bigger than 1, one can still solve this. And when P goes to 1, the formal limit drops out this term, so you get a first order differential equation with these boundary conditions. Now that's two boundary conditions for a first order equation is one too many, and you get this as a viscosity solution. And the viscosity solution violates this boundary condition in the classical sense. But it satisfies the differential equation in the classical sense, and therefore it satisfies the boundary condition in the viscosity sense. So therefore, one should expect when P goes to 1, when P is bigger than 1, the Dirichlet condition is attained in the classical sense. When P goes to 1, you have the development of a boundary layer. And in general, one should also expect that for general domains, that the first eigenfunction converges to something which satisfies the limiting equation in the viscosity sense and also the boundary condition in the viscosity sense. For P between 1 and infinity, this is a Bessel-type equation, and one can use it to derive, an orthonormal system of eigenfunctions in a suitably weighted L2 space. And they form a countable, but presumably incomplete set of eigenfunctions to this eigenvalue problem, because there may also be non-radial eigenfunctions, except that we have not been able to find any explicitly for general P. Let me finish with a few open problems. First one is the first Dirichlet eigenfunction unique at least for convex omega? For non-convex omega is known to be non-convex. What are the normal patterns on the disk for any P between P not equal to 0? It's conjectured that the nodal line should be a diameter. And the last one is the hotspot conjecture. Hotspot conjecture says the second eigenfunction takes its maximum and minimum on the boundary, second Neumann eigenfunction. And this is known for P equal to 1, P equal to infinity. It has been conjectured for P equal to, and there have been very strong attempts to, by very powerful people to solve this. And of course it is not totally absurd conjecture that maybe it's true for any P between 1 and infinity. But again, if one can prove it for P equal to 2, I would also be very happy because I spent many years trying to prove it. So thank you for your attention.